Hi guys, Erin here. In this video, you'll learn about measurement validity and reliability, or how to ensure that a measurement procedure is accurate and consistent. Here's where this video fits into the context of our course. So if you remember from last video, we talked about operational definitions, or how to take an abstract construct and turn it into something that we can observe and measure. And we said that there are ways that you can measure how good your measurement procedure is. This is the idea behind measurement validity and reliability, or how well does a test measure what it claims to be measuring, and how stable or consistent are the results from the test. Just as a side note, measurement validity is related to the concept of internal validity, but it's not the same thing. We'll be talking about internal validity more in week 4. So let's get started. How many of you have ever played darts or archery? Well, if you have, you'll know that the goal is to hit the target and to do so every time you try. The same can be said about measurement procedures. Let's say, for example, you're interested in measuring mental health. You would want to set up a testing procedure where you are measuring mental health. You can imagine mental health now being the center of your dartboard target. This is the idea behind validity. And you would want this testing procedure to measure mental health every time you measured it. This is the idea behind reliability. So let's start with measurement validity. How well does a test measure what it claims to be measuring? How well, for example, does IQtest.com actually measure your intelligence? Well, your textbook gives 6 different definitions of measurement validity. It's a lot, I know. Let's see if we can break it down so it's a little bit easier to digest. Those 6 definitions can basically be fit into 2 different categories: the extent to which the content in a measuring procedure is appropriate, and how the test scores on the test relates to scores on other tests. Let's start over on the left. Construct validity is a little bit abstract. It's kind of the goal of everything. Does the test relate to the underlying theoretical concept? Does IQtest.com relate to your intelligence? This is a little bit fuzzy in itself, especially when we don't have a clear definition as a field of what intelligence is. Face validity is a little bit more superficial, but it's easier to sink your teeth into. It's ask the question, does the test appear to test what it aims to test? It's a bit of a tongue twister. Does the test have the look and feel of what you think about when you think of intelligence? Maybe to you, intelligence is related to school ability. Maybe it involves problem solving, for example. If that what comes to mind to you when you think of intelligence, then your testing procedure should also reflect that. Over on the right, we have a number of different definitions of measurement validity that have to do with how scores on a test relate to scores on other tests. If you remember in last video when we showed those scatter plots, this is kind of the idea here too. Concurrent validity and convergent validity are really similar. It's basically asking, do scores on the IQtest.com relate to scores on another IQ test, especially one that's already been standardized and has been shown to be valid? You would want, if IQtest.com is actually measuring your intelligence, and we as a field assume that the WASI IQ test is also measuring intelligence, then we would assume that somebody who scores high on IQtest.com would also score high on the WASI. Somebody who scores low on one should also score low on the other. This is the idea underlying convergent and concurrent validity. Divergent validity says that if the IQtest.com is actually measuring intelligence, you would predict that there'd be no relationship. There'd so no pattern of results. It would all just be a bubble, a cloud of scatters in that scatter plot. You'd show no relationship between your scores on that test and some other test that has nothing to do with your intelligence. For example, how well you can do this while jumping up and down on one foot and saying the alphabet, for example. I don't know. Maybe you'll agree with me that that is not a test of intelligence. If that's not a test of intelligence, then we should show no relationship with scores on IQtest.com. Predictive validity asks, does the test predict later performance on some related criterion? this is actually one of the criticisms of standardized IQ testing, especially ones that have a more narrow definition of intelligence, like the WASI. You would assume that somebody who performs well on an IQ test should also, I don't know, have a well-paying job, do well at university, for example. But this is not actually the case. And this is one of the criticisms of standardized IQ tests. They don't have high predictive validity. Check out these links if you'd like more information. Reliability is about how stable or consistent a measurement procedure is. The idea behind this is that your measured score is a combination of your true actual score as well as some error. And that error can come from you, the person taking the test. Maybe your attention starts getting diverted, or maybe you start getting tired. It could come from the environment. Maybe there's distractions around you, a loud noise blaring. If you're taking the test while that loud noise is going, you're probably not going to do as well as if there was no noise. And if that noise is part of the testing procedure, it's not going to be very reliable. If that error can also come from the measurement procedure itself. So for example, on iqtest.com, you have to answer really quickly on your computer. And if your computer has some time lag, or if the internet connection fades out, then your performance on that test is gonna suggest lower performance than your actual skills. So a reliable measure doesn't leave much room for error. To give you an example of that, I don't know if any of you guys have ever been in this situation where you have to measure the length of a room, for example, and you don't have measuring tape, and so you try to use your feet to gauge how many feet across is the room. Well, if you're using your feet, it's probably going to give you like a ballpark estimate of how big your room is, but it's clearly not going to be as accurate as a measuring tape. This is the idea behind reliability. You can actually measure how reliable a measurement procedure is. And there's three different ways that you can do this, and it can be broken into two categories that are about about internal consistency or external consistency. How consistent is the test with itself, and how consistent are scores on the test with scores on across other uses? So in terms of internal consistency, the way that we measure that is called the split half procedure. So what we would do is administer a test, and we would compare people's performance on across different items to see if they're related to each other. So let's say if as a class we all did iqtest.com, we would look to see if our scores, let's say on odd numbered items, were similar to even numbered items. For example, if a test has high internal consistency, then we would show a strong positive correlation. This allows you to say whether all questions on the test are at all contributing and measuring that construct of intelligence. External consistency can be measured in two ways: test retest and inter-rater reliability. Test retest reliability is what we would do is we would take the test twice, and we'd look to see if performance on, let's say, version A of a test and version B of the test are similar. Or let's use another example, your weight. Your weight's probably not gonna fluctuate very much if we measure it right now and if we measure it in half an hour. If we as a class all did that and we plotted our scores now and in half an hour, we would assume that there would be a strong correlation in our scores. You would want this for an intelligence test too, because you wouldn't wanna have a test that changes across time. You would wanna have a test that gives you a stable, consistent measure. In inter-rater reliability, you have two people observe some behavior and you look to see if their scores are similar. So for example, let's say I ask somebody from seminar one and somebody from seminar four to go through all of these videos I've made for you and count the amount of times I say If you guys both come up with a consistent number for each video that you watch, then you would have high inter-rater reliability. Hopefully I don't say too much. If you want more information about this, check out that link. So all of this is to say is that your results are only as good as a measurement. When you're reading studies, you want to read that a testing procedure is valid, measuring what it claims to be measuring, and reliable, is giving consistent results. Similarly, when you come to do your own research, you want to propose a research design that is also valid and reliable. So just as a suggestion, when you go to write your research proposal, you're going to have to propose a measurement procedure to measure that construct that you're interested in. I highly suggest that you don't try to come up with your own quiz or questionnaire. It's really hard to show that a testing procedure is valid and reliable. Your whole proposal would be showing that. It's much better to use a measure that other people have already shown is validated and reliable. So for example, let's say you're interested in mental health, you can use the Beck Depression Inventory, for example. That's all for this video. Thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next time.